Hello friends, welcome to our new initiative Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be analyzing the news articles from The Hindu, The Indian Express, LiveMint and PIB for the day 16th October 2018. The news articles we'll be covering today are these 8. And apart from these 8 articles, few other news items will be covered in the form of MCQs for the prelims. And a PDF is attached in the description below. Kindly download a PDF for your reference. The first article we'll be seeing today is The Rising Stock of Global Economic Risks. This article was taken from the newspaper LiveMint and it talks about the challenges that the global economy in the current day faces. So the downward risks faced by the global economy is predicted by many financial institutions. For example, of International Monetary Fund, the World Economic Outlook and the Global Financial Stability Report of IMF. All these three highlights a risk faced by the global financial system. So what are the factors causing these risks? The first factor can be attributed to the rising trade tension. For example, the increasing friction in US and China relation will definitely have its effect on the global scenario, and this will increase the risks faced by the global economy. And the second factor causing the risks is tightening of global financial condition, which in turn will affect the liquidity, that is the flow of money into the Indian economy. And the third factor causing the risks is the rising crude oil prices. So according to the latest report, still 99.8% of the global energy needs is met by the crude oil. So the rise in crude oil prices is a very important factor in maintaining the economic stability. So what can be the possible causes for this global economic risks? So number one can be due to accommodative monetary policy followed by most of the global countries. And because of this accommodative policy, which results in increase in the money supply into the economy. So this in turn will lead to increase in asset prices, especially in different markets. And this will lead to overvaluation in the stock market and it creates excesses. So this whole process can influence the inflow of money into the emerging economies, especially like India and Brazil. So let's see a bit more into the factors. Number one is the interest rate. So this hike in interest rate in USA, it indicates a recovery of US market from the global slowdown, and which will make the investors prefer the market in USA rather than in other emerging economies. So this will have a considerable impact in the markets of the emerging economies, including India. The second factor is the policy space. Most of the developing countries as well as the developed countries, they do not have any significant crisis plan in order to face a risk condition. So this is a very serious issue which will make a country prone to economic risks. So the third factor is rising trade tensions. So as we saw before, the IMF report, it says that the global GDP will fall by about 0.8% in 2020 because of the rising trade tensions between different countries of the world. And this may push many countries into protectionist spree, for example, what is currently happening in USA, and which will in turn have its impact on the global trade. So now let's see what the case of India. So how will these factors impact Indian scenario? So because of the factors which we saw now, the foreign portfolio investors have sold about 14 billion stocks out of India. And one of the important factors for this is, as we saw before, the hike in the federal rate in USA. The second factor is widening CAD and the higher crude oil prices, which will definitely have a pressure on Indian rupee. So because of these two factors, rising tariff rate alone won't be enough, as it's just a short-term solution. So we need a long-term solution with prudent macroeconomic policy in order to bring in stability into our country. So this is highly essential in order to manage the emerging risks the economy faces, and it can be brought in by improving the convergence and cooperation between the various other countries with similar scenarios. The second article we'll be seeing today is How India Can Overcome Zero Hunger Challenge. So this article was also taken from the paper LiveMint today. And few days back, the International Food Policy and Research Institute, they released a 2018 Global Hunger Index. So in that index, which ranks 119 countries, India stood at 103. So this is 3 places down from its past 2017 year ranking, so which calls for serious issues in our policy in addressing various health and nutrition related issues. So with a score of 31.1, India has been placed under category of serious countries in par with many other African countries. So on studying any index, one has to study the following factors from the prelims perspective. Number one is, what is the index? And who is the index is released by which organization? And what are the factors taken into consideration for that index? So here, when the global hunger index is taken, so the four factors for this index are: number one is undernourishment, number two is child wasting, number three is child stunting, and number four is child mortality. All these factors together are taken into consideration for calculating a country's rank. So now let's come into the scenario of India. So the concept of hunger is not just about the nutrition. It is a multidimensional phenomenon which includes other factors like economic and social issues. So empirically speaking, about 815 million people globally are suffering from chronic undernourishment according to this index. And this calls for serious reforms in design and development systems, which may focus on broadly the areas of food production, processing, preservation, and distribution. Let's now discuss all these areas in detail with respect to India. One of the important reasons for increasing in hunger in India is because of the lack of warehousing and cold storage facilities. So according to the statistics, 7% of food production and 30% of the fruits and vegetables every year is wasted in India. And this not just results in increasing in phenomenon of hunger, and it also affects India's GDP considerably. So in order to decrease the prevalence of hunger in India, India needs to invest more in food production, processing, preservation, as well as the distribution. So one of the important mechanisms for this is bringing in infrastructural development in the cold chain facility. For example, initiatives of Government of India like Sampada, which gives considerable importance to the food infrastructure facilities, including the cold chain, is a very good initiative in this direction. So the cold chain facilities must be linked with the remunerative markets, and which will in turn maintain the quality of the food produced, and which will in turn reduce the wastage of food. And another important statistics according to the Food and Agricultural Organization is, the food wastage causes almost 8% of the emission of the global greenhouse gases. So what are the possible measures which India needs to take in order to counter this hunger challenge? The first measure which needs to be taken is developing and upgrading the rural infrastructure. So as we all know, about 60% of Indians still live in rural area. Developing and upgrading this rural infrastructure is very much essential for addressing the issue of hunger. And second is training farmers in post-harvest practices that will in turn minimize the losses. The next important measure which needs to be addressed is integrating the small chain enterprises into the value chain. So organizing the small holder farmers into farmer producer organization, especially in the form of cooperative groups, is a very essential reform. Bringing in customized financial services as well as investment in agricultural research is a must. So channelizing the last mail marketing channels is a positive step in this direction. So as we trace the history, any civilization is bound to grow only when the food producers, that is the agricultural sector, improves. So when a tillage begins, the other arts follow. The farmers, therefore, are the founders of human civilization, says this quote. So in addressing the issue of hunger is also essential for India to achieve its sustainable development goal number 2, which calls for elimination of hunger from India. It is eliminating hunger as an issue is also necessary to ensure social equity, gender inclusiveness, and reducing agriculture's carbon footprint. So this is also in parallel with the constitutional principles of providing equality to every citizen in our country. And this further will reduce the overall poverty in all forms from our country. So the next article we'll be seeing is taken from PIB. So this article is with relevance to the prelims perspective. So it is about the BharatNet project of India. So this BharatNet project is a project of national importance which was started in the year 2017. So this project, it calls for bringing in highly scalable network infrastructure which is accessible on a non-discriminatory basis, which will provide on-demand affordable broadband connectivity. And this will not just provide broadband connectivity, but it also provides a high speed broadband connectivity of about 2 to 20 Mbps for all the households as well as all the institutions. So it will help India realize its vision of Digital India, that is bringing in a complete digitalization by the year 2022. And this program is in partnership with the states and the private sector as well. The program is funded by a Universal Service Obligation Fund, which is a fund exclusively created to improve the telecom sector in our country. The objective of this fund will in turn help in delivery of e-governance, e-health, education, banking and other internet facilities to rural India, which will in turn increase the efficiency of service delivery to in Indian economy. So this project is a collaboration work between the center and the state, and the main role of the state is to establish the optical fiber network necessary for initiating the communication channels. So this is a three-phase project. The first phase, which will provide connectivity to about 1 lakh gram panchayats via optical fiber cable. And according to the government data, this target of providing 1 lakh gram panchayats connectivity has been achieved by December 2017. And the second phase, it proposes to extend this digital connectivity to all the gram panchayats, which is about 2,50,500 in India, via optimal mix of underground fiber, fiber over power lines, and radio as well as satellite media. And according to government data, about 50% of this target has been achieved currently, and rest of it will be achieved by March 2019. The last mile connectivity to the citizens, as well proposed by this scheme, by creating Wi-Fi hotspots in many relevant areas such as railway station, bus stands, etc. and other public places as well as the gram panchayats. So the third phase of the program, which will start from 2019 to 2023, it will provide state-of-art facilities, which will bring in other state-of-art facilities to provide a future-proof network by addressing the issues of privacy as well. So the next item we'll be seeing is more than 1.65 crore households connected since the launch of Saubhagya. So what is this Saubhagya scheme? So this Saubhagya scheme, it is an initiative of Ministry of Power, and it is also called as Pradhan Mantri Sahaj Bijli Har Ghar Yojana. It aims at providing electricity connection to every single household in our country, regardless of their economic scenario, by the end of 2022. So the electricity connection is provided to both above poverty line as well as poor families, covering both rural as well as urban areas. So the beneficiaries are chosen according to socio-economic caste census 2011. So the Rural Electrification Corporation of India is designated as the nodal agency for implementation of the Saubhagya scheme. And there are around 4 crore unelectrified households in our country, and they will be targeted for this electricity connection by the end of December 2018. So according to recently released data by the Government of India, more than 1.6 crore households has already been connected under this Saubhagya scheme. In order to increase the reach and increase the efficiency in bringing the reach under the scheme, the government has also announced a 100 crore award for states who are providing effective electrification under the Saubhagya scheme. This is also in spirit with bringing in cooperative federalism between different states of the country. So this award scheme is the manifestation of the principle of competitive federalism followed by the union government, which may in turn increase the efficiency of service delivery between different states. So the next article we'll be seeing today is falling short on most of the counts. So this article, it talks about the Government of India scheme of Ayushman Bharat. So before studying any welfare scheme, one definitely have to concentrate on what the scheme is about, what are the positives of the scheme, as well as what are the limitations of the scheme. So let's see the features of Ayushman Bharat scheme. So first feature is, it will cover about 100 million beneficiaries across India, and the limit of 5 lakh per family is given under the scheme, and there's no limit to the family size under Ayushman scheme. So the families are identified based on socio-economic caste census 2011, and the share between the center and the state is of 60:40. So the existing schemes under the states will be merged under the ambit of Ayushman Bharat, and this will be implemented through insurance company or a trust or society set up specifically for this scheme. And this scheme will also be driven by strategic purchasing with the involvement of the private sector in the health domain. So this Ayushman Bharat scheme, it plans to increase the health insurance penetration in India, and as well as address the out-of-pocket expenditure existing in the health sector, which almost stands at around 67% currently. However, not all is well with this scheme. So this scheme also faces considerable challenges which needs to be addressed for effective implementation of the program. So let's see what are the challenges faced by this program. So number one is the enrollment of the ghost beneficiaries. That is, the issue of fake beneficiaries getting into the ambit of the health scheme is very high, which needs to be addressed. And also another issue existing with the identification of beneficiaries is with respect to the socio-economic caste census 2011. So according to recent guidelines released by the government, few of the people which come under these categories are not eligible for the Ayushman Bharat scheme. For example, people who earn more than 10,000 per month, or people who own fridge, two-wheeler, three-wheeler or four-wheelers, or the farmers having considerable land holdings, or fishermen having a fishing boat, as well as the normal citizens who file income tax return as well as professional tax, are not eligible for this Ayushman Bharat scheme. So this may create an issue in identification of the eligible beneficiaries under the Ayushman Bharat scheme. So addressing this inclusion as well as exclusion error under the scheme is very much essential. So the second set of issue is due to the involvement of the private sector hospital into the scheme. So a few private sector hospitals may be profit oriented, and they may undergo the process of converting out of patient into inpatient in order to claim the benefits under the Ayushman Bharat scheme. So they may also go for deliberate blocking of higher priced packages which are covered under the scheme. As we saw before, this scheme covers both private as well as public sector hospitals, and most of the public sector hospitals, they do not have proper technology as well as infrastructure, many of the significant diseases. And there's also serious claims that the doctors are performing unnecessary procedures in the places where it's not necessarily required. For example, the increasing cases of cesarean deliveries, as well as the increasing incidences of hysterectomy in and the associated deaths due to it, are the examples of this cause. Though this initiative is a cashless initiative, it is seen that many hospitals, they charge fee in spite of it. So all these issues need to be addressed for positive implementation of the scheme. So next article we'll be seeing today is Data Addicted, 15 Players Failed to Comply. So this article was taken from the Hindu newspaper. And what is the background of this issue? So the RBI, which is the Central Bank of India, has given a deadline for the payment players like Amazon, Google, WhatsApp payment services, etc. to store their data locally within India. And this deadline is coming to end on Monday. And it is believed that about 15% of the entities listed out by the RBI, so they are yet to fully comply with the directives given by the RBI. So what is data localization? So the process of data localization, it deals with the storage of data in the data center on the internet in the same country where the data is originated. So this data localization concept is very essential from two dimensions. Number one is the privacy issues for different individuals in the country. And number two is it poses a serious security threat to the national security. So this RBI circular is independent of the data protection laws. So it will stand only as a test of proportionality. So that is whether the data localization is a just process or not. That is the only issue involved here. So these guidelines of RBI, they apply only to those entities which, such as the payment systems which are under the governance of the RBI. So next issue we'll be seeing today is hamstringing the RTI Act. So what is this Right to Information Act? So this Right to Information Act, it was operationalized in the year 2005. So it is a very powerful tool for citizen empowerment, as well as it exposes the wrongdoings at the very higher places. For example, some of the significant exposures by this Right to Information Act includes organization of Commonwealth Games and the corruption involved therein, and the corruption charges of 2G spectrum case as well. However, the act does face multiple challenges which we'll be discussing now. So the first problem faced by this act is increasing number of frivolous queries. So the queries are not just from valid right activists. So the complaints under this act not just come from serious right activists, but also from the unsatisfied government servants, which is a serious concern. The Section 4 of the RTI Act, it requires sumo disclosure of lot of information by the public authority. So what constitutes public authority is one question. And also the disclosures made by the public authority have remained very less than satisfactory in most of the cases. Both the central as well as the state information commission, so they have less than the prescribed maximum strength of 11, because the government has dragged their feet in appointing the information commissioners at both state as well as the central level. So this has resulted in delay in disposal of cases in most of the instances. And another issue is the number of decisions taken by the information commission are challenged at the various high courts. So this increases the case burden of the judiciary as well, as and it increases the efficiency of the service delivery as well. So in this context, the government of India has proposed a series of amendments to this 2005 act. So what are these amendments? So the current existing 2005 act, It places information commissioners in par with the election commissioners as far as their tenure is concerned. So this amendment which is proposed, it plans to take away this fixed 5-year tenure as per the wishes of the existing government, which will definitely take away the integrity of the information commission as an organization. The Justice Shri Krishna Committee has proposed amendments that it broaden the definition of the term harm. So thereby, this will definitely restrict the disclosure of the personal information which was already provided under the Right to Information Act to the people of the country. So the Right to Information Act, it continues to render effective service in providing information to the citizens. Though the aim of this RTI Act is not grievance redressal mechanism, it does spur public authorities to address their grievances because of the information delivered via this act. So any amendments to dilute the provisions of Right to Information Act will pose a threat to the transparency and the good governance in the country. The last article we'll be discussing today is with respect to ecologically sensitive areas. So this deals with the recent notification by the Environment Ministry to extend the ESA tag to 57,000 square kilometers of the Western Ghat in its new draft notification. So what is the background of this news? So we all know the state of Kerala has witnessed the devastating floods recently, and many ecologists have attributed the non-compliance for the Gadgil Committee report as one of the main factor for the devastating effects the floods caused on the Western Ghats. So the National Green Tribunal of India has criticized the Environmental Ministry for non-finalizing the ESA for the Western Ghat region, due to which the ministry was forced to release this draft notification. So according to the released notification, 57,000 square kilometers of the Western Ghats will be declared as ecologically sensitive areas. And this means that many projects including mining, quarrying and thermal power plants is completely banned from the Western Ghats, which comprises of almost 6 states in our country. So now let's see the difference between the Gadgil Committee recommendation, which was proposed in the year 2010, and the Kasturirangan Committee recommendation, which was produced in 2013. So according to the Gadgil Committee recommendation, the entire Western Ghats is to be considered as ecologically sensitive area. However, this proposal was diluted by the Kasturirangan Committee, as it proposed only 37% of the Western Ghats under ecologically sensitive area category. According to the Gadgil Committee, the recommendation, it followed a bottom-up approach, which means that it gave considerable importance to the decisions taken by the Gram Panchayats. So the Gram Panchayats played a very crucial role in decision making with respect to the Western Ghats area, according to the Gadgil Committee report. However, this power was also altered by the Kasturirangan Committee report, which gave the major decision making responsibility to the government as well as the bureaucracy, that is the forest officials in the Western Ghats area. And another change between Gadgil and the Kasturirangan Committee is with respect to the recognition of the ecologically sensitive zone. According to Gadgil Committee report, it classified the ESA into 3 broad categories, that is Zone 1, Zone 2 and Zone 3. And the Zone 1, it includes the highly protected area where there is a complete ban on mining, construction as well as other infrastructure development activities. However, according to Kasturirangan Committee report, hydroelectric power plants were permitted within the ESA area after a detailed study. The Kasturirangan Committee also recommended a ban on quarrying, mining and sand mining in ecologically sensitive areas. And according to Gadgil Committee report, the Western Ghat Ecological Authority needs to be constituted under the Ministry of Environment and Forest Change. This authority will be constituted under the Environment Act and it will be given a statutory status. However, Kasturirangan Committee did not propose any setting up of authority as such. So it just proposed it for strengthening of the current legal framework existing in our country. So from the prelims perspective, so Western Ghat is an important geological landform in our country, which is at the fringe of western coast of India. So it basically separates the peninsular India from the Arabian Ocean. So the UNESCO has included many parts of Western Ghats under its famous UNESCO World Heritage List. So this UNESCO World Natural Heritage List, it comprises of places which are very rich in endemic biodiversity across different parts of the world. So the Western Ghat is the source of origin for many peninsular rivers such as Godavari, Krishna and Kaveri. And the Western Ghat, it extends approximately 1500 km from the Tapti River in the north and till the Kanyakumari in the south. And the average elevation of Western Ghat is not more than 600 meters and it transverses through 6 states, that is namely Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Karnataka, Kerala and Tamil Nadu.